What is this shit?
Yeah, what is this? God.
Scott, man, great to talk to you. Welcome to my show. So we're here and we're talking with Scott Reeder. And my first question for Scott Reeder is, how many Scott Reeders do you know in the music world or out of the music world? And other than that, do you know any others?
Well, there's the guy in Fu Manchu that I have not met yet, but we've got to do a project together just to fuck with everybody. I get letters that are meant for him all the time. Hey, man, I'm going to be at the Boston show. Can you hook me up on the guest list for Fu Manchu? Man. I might be people back. Yeah, you got the wrong guy, man. I don't know.
That's the first one that comes to your mind. And yeah, then what about rhymes? What about rhymes, like, with your name? And I'm sorry to be so silly at the being like Scott Reeder, and then there's other names that are very close to this. And
Not Eater.
Right.
I get Snot Eater a lot.
You get Snot Eater?
Yeah.
Scott, that's not what I was expecting. That's great. I'll tell you some funny things. Like, we grew up with a guy named Scott Reegers. This is trouble. And we're like young kids. Like, from anywhere from being 18 through when our first stuff came out with Metal Blade. And Scott Reegers was an awesome bass player, and he was from Aurora, like the Chicago Aurora area, and dude, really cool. And what?
Wayne's World.
Yes. And when I talked to Greg Anderson about the name thing, there's Scott Reeger. You know, like, it's Scott Reeger from St. Vitus. So we have this big mixing with the names that are going on. And then we said...
Oh, yeah. I got a phone call from somebody one time. And they were, don't you remember me? It was some guy named Marshall. It was a friend of Wino's. And so, come on, man. We met at this one club. And, like, everything he was saying was, like, so close. And I had no memory of this guy. And he finally said, this is Scott Reeger's, right? I'm like... No, it's Scott Reeder. I guess he saw some numbers scrawled on a pad or something at Wino's place and dialed up Scott, who he thought was Reeger's. It took us like 10 minutes to figure it out. What the fuck?
That call, he might have been calling you because of the... That's Marshall Stacks. Mm-hmm. I believe if his name is Marshall, and this happened in your, like, your... recording, you know, memorabilia in history, that could be Marshall Stacks. And he was a dude that they were trying to get to sing for St. Vitus.
I think that is true.
And so it would be cool to find out what just happened with that. That is really cool. The running gag that we said is that all of the names, Scott Reeder, Scott Reeders, Scott Reeger, Scott Reegers, all those guys should get together and form a band and call themselves the Winslows.
The Winslows.
We just couldn't think of any neutral name for you guys. But Scott, what's your favorite thing right now that you're doing in rock and roll and your life?
Oh, I'm all over the place right now. I just did a bass track for a band called Anger Tea and Hungry.
Cool.
That's kind of, I don't want to say Tool-esque, but kind of in that vein, really melodic but heavy. I just started a track when the phone rang with John McBain. He sent me some tracks this morning.
Wow.
And getting ready to put the bass down on this song. It's very Zeppelin-y, Pink Floyd-y. It's right up my alley.
Yeah.
I haven't even listened to the whole song yet. It's like a 10-minute epic, I think. And it's going to be awesome. I'm stoked. I just heard it. Wow. And, of course, Goatsnake.
Yes.
I just did a little West Coast tour with those guys. Just L.A., Portland, Seattle. Or not Portland, San Francisco and Seattle.
Yeah.
And, man, it was the first time I've really got out and really played in a long time. And had a blast. Everybody was just on top of it. It felt so good.
Great.
Hope to do more. We got a show coming up in L.A. on, I believe, October 30th. And then...
Halloween-ish.
We're playing the... Yeah. And then at the end of May, we're playing the Death Fest in... I think it's in Baltimore. So, yeah, over the next 7 or 8 months, we've got 2 gigs.
So that's the end of May. It's Death Fest. And then we have Goatsnake also in L.A. at October 30th. We just represented Sonic Medusa. And we'll segue into that. Did you have fun working on that? It sounds great, Scott. And I have a lot of questions about that session for the future.
Yeah, those guys were killer. And, you know, I played with Greg years ago, what, almost 20 years ago. And
is that Lunar One, if we say that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Cool.
That was recorded, what, in 91?
91, The Obsessed, so, yeah, Lunar Womb.
Yeah.
Greg Rogers,
and almost
Scott Reedy on bass, Wino, guitar, vocals. Sorry to do that.
Is that right?
You asshole, why do you... It's not sports. Like...
So Tom Five, I actually met Tom on my very first tour with Caius. I forget where we played. It was in New York. I think it's a Wetlands. And met Tom Five for the first time. And we just played some shows with White Zombie before that. It was after he was out of the band, though. But, yeah, so I've known Tom for almost 20 years. This is the first time we've done anything together.
What are your recollections as far back as you can think of when you first picked up your instrument? Like, what do you say when that question is asked? And it's not to make you... You know what I mean? Not to make you feel uncomfortable, but
yeah, well,
when did you
I
start?
I started playing drums actually when I was 4.
Wow.
And I would play like Beatles songs with my dad. He played guitar and the whole family would sing. I had a drum set that I made out of cardboard boxes and a metal trash can and I'd hit, and my drumsticks were like a whistle and a chunk of wood or something.
Oh, that's cool.
Know? And my parents got me a real drum set on my 5th birthday. So that's all I wanted to do, was play drums. I was into the Beatles and Ringo. When I got into school, I wanted to play drums in the band. And I guess everybody wanted to play drums. So the band director steered me away from that into trombone.
Wow.
And I went through school playing trombone. Played in the jazz band, marching band, and all that stuff.
Do you still play trombone? Do you, like, know the positions and scales?
I'm going to break it out on some of my solo stuff one of these days just for the hell of it and freak people out.
Oh, dude, that is killer, man. That's so cool to know. I never knew that.
So, yeah, in high school...
How long did you do that before you switched over? How long did you play trombone?
I had in 6th grade. I played in 6th grade, and I went through sophomore year at UCLA.
So all the way to college?
Yeah.
Okay, that's amazing.
I played in the Olympic band. This is weird. I played in the Olympic band in the 84 Olympics.
Okay, so... Dude, that's...
During the fanfare of the common man, there's a pan that goes across all the trombones up this one aisle, and there was a close-up of my face broadcasting 2.5 billion people.
Huge.
And my mom didn't recognize me. All my friends were like, no way, dude, I fucking tell you.
Okay, continue on. So then what happened?
So I was playing in a punk band in high school. Played a band called Subservice and then a band called Dead Issue. And our bass player quit. And we couldn't find anybody else that was into punk rock that happened to play bass. But there was this drummer by the name of Alfredo Hernandez that was looking to play in a band. So he took up the drum spot, and I bought the guy's fake Rickenbacker copy for $100 and started
turned it over because you're lefty.
Yep.
So did you have to turn it? Or was it a right? Was it a lefty?
It was a right-handed bass, and I didn't bother restringing it because I would flip over my dad's guitars when I was a kid. Yeah, you know, I couldn't just restring it for a few minutes. Hey, Dad, can I check this out? So I would just flip them over, and that's just the way I always learned. So
that's
I
awesome.
Stuck with it.
So do you play reverse like Hendrix then, or what? I mean, do you play what's your string setup? What is your first string, second string?
It's actually strung right-handed. The fat strings are at the bottom, which I think works better for the bass because you don't have to... Yeah, I mean, most of the notes that you play on bass, you want to hit them low. So with the fat strings at the bottom, you don't have to reach all the way across the neck and mute the bottom strings. It's just right there. I think it's more ergonomically easy to play that way.
And so then you did that, and then you just kept going. When did it all come together professionally with the, you know, labels and these time frames like that? When did this all start to turn more? This is it. I'm doing what I love to do.
Well, yeah, that bandana issue kind of morphed into Across the River when we left our singer.
Mm-hmm.
And that was Mario Lolly, who's now in Fast and Jetson. And Alfredo Hernandez, who of course was in Queens of the Stone Age and Caius. Across the River started playing with a lot of the SST bands. One of our first
SST bands?
We were really, we played with St. Vitus.
Yep.
In 85, I think, when Scott Regers was still in the band. And that was a huge one for us. We got to play the Anti Club in LA with St. Vitus. That was, you know, one of the bands we were really into.
Wow, cool. And,
so, yeah, we just kept going Across the River for a couple of years. And then I moved to LA probably around 86, 87, actually, right after I got married to Renee. And this is really weird how Wino tracked me down. We played together a couple of shows. Actually, the first time I met him was a show with DRI, St. Vitus, and Across the River at the Palm Desert Community Center. It was my 21st birthday, and it was Wino's first gig ever with St. Vitus. And this guy comes out to the desert, and it's roasting hot outside, and he jumps out of the van with leather and conchos, and like, who's this guy? Where's Scott Regers? And we hit it off that night, and we ended up jamming at a party a couple months after that. It was a generator party out in Ventura by the beach, and I played drums, Wino played guitar, and Mario Lolly played bass, and the people there, we just jammed out for like a half an hour and had a great time, and we were like, dude, we gotta fucking do it again someday. And this is like, what, a couple of years down the road that I moved to LA, I won an MTV contest. I was hooking up a VCR at my in-law's house, and my sister-in-law came in the room, and she said, they're flashing a phone number for the U2 contest. I'm all, huh. So I, what the hell, I dialed this number a few times and get this recording, and finally this voice came on the line and said, hold on a second, like, I must have got a wrong number, and I almost hung up. And somebody came back on, you're today's winner, and they gave me $1,000, a bunch of MTV merch, they had a limo pick us up at the house, take us to the airport, flew a Learjet out to Arizona to see U2 and BB King when they were filming Rattle and Hum. And so that day Wino's watching TV and he saw my name flashing on MTV, and it's Scott Reeder of North Hollywood. Oh no shit, Reeder lives out here now. So somehow he found Renee's parents' phone number and called them and
stalked,
got her number,
you.
And that's how we finally hooked up.
Oh, that is just great.
Thanks to MTV.
Thanks to MTV.
So I think the beginning of this question was leading up to, like, the first pro tour.
Yeah.
And got a little sidetracked there. But But yeah, with the Obsessed, we had a very short time. He actually had another bass player. This is a few years later. He had this guy, Danny, and the guy had a motorcycle accident. What's that? He I don't know where he was from. He was in a band with Greg Rogers before that. And so they were trying to throw this thing together for the Obsessed tour in Germany. And like 2 months, I think, before the tour was supposed to happen, he had this motorcycle wreck and he was in a coma.
Mm.
And Wino called me and said, "Hey, man, what do you think? Can you do this tour?" And just like, fuck yeah. I jumped on it. And we threw things together really fast and went to Germany in 91 in April.
Wow.
And I think we toured for 3 weeks. And then, I mean, by the end of that tour, we were so tight. And we went straight into a recording studio in Berlin and knocked out Lunar Womb in 5 days, recorded and mixed.
Killer, bro. Absolutely killer. How did that happen? Did you guys just... You just said that that record was recorded after a tour, right?
Yes.
Did you sit down and guys work out those timing patterns? You know, all those meter changes and things that occur?
Yeah. We had it all worked out, but we hadn't played that song live, so we kind of stuffed it out in the studio. And we'd play until somebody screwed up, and then we'd roll tape back a few bars and punch in. And we weren't sure if it was going to work or not, but it was seamless. It worked just fine.
Sure.
But there's a few punches in that song. We cheated a little bit.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with that. That's why it's called a recording studio, and a lot of people don't get that. What are your reflections on your new music? How do you feel about that?
My solo stuff?
Yeah. Are you just enjoying yourself and scripting and just enjoying recording and working on things? Or, I mean, what's...
Yeah, I mean, I'm working on other people's stuff mostly. I don't do much of my solo stuff. I have to be pretty pissed off to actually get motivated to put something down. Or, you know, something emotionally intense has to be going on. I don't, you know, I'm not... in a record deal where I have to put out product every year and a half or anything like that. So it's just, you know, whenever I feel like it. I don't feel like it very often.
Right.
I'm having a blast working with other people. You know, just so many cool people have come through here and amazing musicians. And it's been a good run this year, especially.
I think you are probably enjoying that in your studio. And so
yeah, I never know what's going to happen here. You know, you never know when something's going to pop up, and everything's always unexpected, and it's always fun, you know. I'm not booked 24/7, 50 weeks a year, or anything like that. Just,
that's cool.
Yeah, it's pretty much word of mouth, and usually there's some friend in a band that comes in, and if not... their friends when they leave.
When did you buy the ranch and start all this?
Yeah, it was probably in 2000 that we bought the ranch, and the building of the studio was a very slow process. I was pretty good with a sledgehammer knocking down the walls in this extra building that was here. There was a barn at one point, and they added on a master bedroom at one end, and a kitchen at one end, and an entryway, and I just came through with a sledgehammer and knocked as much out as I could without getting electrocuted. I had an electrician come through and help me with the wiring, and then he helped me tighten things up just before the Freaks came in, actually. They booked a couple of weeks here, and I got a big fat advance, for me, and... got things finally tightened up here, and it started looking like a real recording studio.
Wow.
And, word spread since then. That was Ruben Romano and John McBain. And I was supposed to play bass on the Freaks project, So it was going to be, you know, the bass guy from Caius, the guitar guy from Monster Magnet, and the drummer from Fu Manchu and Nebula. And I was stoked. Oh, man, I envisioned going on tour with these guys and lit it up. And a week before they came in, I busted my finger. Fuck.
You're kidding me. So your main picking plectrum, your finger.
Yeah, it was on my fretting hand.
This is your left, middle?
Right middle finger, my fretting hand.
Oh, you're right, your fretting hand.
Yeah. And I managed to get through one bluesy bass line thing, like walking lines. I had a bunch of wine and managed to get through it, but I was hurting real bad the next day. Oh, man.
Here we go. It's time for the history question. We have Scott Reeder. Many, many bands. The Obsessed, Caius, and much, much more. Goat Snake. We're going to be seeing a lot of this guy and hearing a lot of his music. He's a wonderful guy. We're going to ask him tonight the history question. What happened on November 19th,
1863? Abraham Lincoln.
Yes, yes.
Big speech. Gettysburg Address.
Oh, man. You're right. This is wonderful. Okay, now it's going to get more challenging. It seemed too easy. A lot of people, you know, can remember. You know, I don't know. Who is someone in the studio, like, prop you for that last session? I don't know.
I have no internet access.
Tom Five. I know it was Tom Five, wasn't it? I bet it was him. All right. Here's your next one, though. This is your next question.
Okay.
But I'm gonna read you a line from that exact speech. This is really hard. I know I'm going to stump somebody one of these days. And this is a really hard line. And it, when you hear this line, you have to tell me which line it is in the speech. Number 1, 2, 3, 4, 27th, whatever it is. Here we go. I'm quoting Abraham Lincoln here in the Gettysburg Address. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this.
Let's see. 67 years ago, our forefathers to form one perfect union. I'd say fourth or fifth.
Ah! Which one, dude?
Let's go fourth.
Oh! You're right! Scott Reeder. Oh, my God. That's two in a row. Last night I interviewed Lizard Man. He was 100%. What is going on here? What is your favorite bass and amp of choice for live?
I've been using Ampeg stuff since 85 now. I've got a 69 SVT and a 1970 SVT. And I have a couple of rack mount Ampegs, but they don't cut it compared to those old ones. There's this creamy overdrive that you can't get with the newer amps. Bass-wise, I played Rickenbacker forever, and it kept falling apart on the road. I was smashing pick guard, busting the neck pickup, and it always sounded different when I'd replace it with a new pickup. You could get whatever you could find on the road. And the last time, one of the last times Caius recorded, we were in the studio getting set up, and at that point in time, the Rickenbacker sounded like crap. And Joe Barisi had a friend over at Ibanez. He brought some stuff in. And I liked the sound of their ATK bass. And I ended up using that on most of the record. I used a fretless Gibson Thunderbird on a few songs.
Wow.
But Ibanez ended up doing this endorsement deal with me. And if I broke anything on the road, they would send another bass out if I needed it. You know, it was pretty good for me because I like to bash things around a lot. And so I've been playing Ibanez. On the Goat Snake trip, I played a 5-string bass, but I don't like the feeling of the 5 strings, so I just took the top string off and just played with the low strings. And it's tuned down to A, actually.
Oh, that's great. Wow. Were those Rickenbackers, those weird stereo output Rickenbackers? You know how they have that weird pickup?
Yeah, the Wicko sound.
Yeah.
I've got one of those adapter boxes, and it just splits the pickups into different amps. And it's kind of cool, but if your backup bass doesn't have that, then you're screwed. You know?
Sure, yeah.
So yep. Unless you have a backup bass that has the Wicko sound output, it's not a good thing. And I shy away from that pretty fast.
Yeah, I'd have to have
cool,
maybe
though.
Five of those basses.
Yeah.
Okay, then in the recording studio, let's just then say, what's your favorite preamp in your studio that really gives you a lot of love? It's your baby. What's your preamp that you love to use a lot?
I'm staring at it right now. It's a Chandler Limited. And it's a dual preamp, and it's a special edition licensed by Abbey Road, and it's the exact replica of what they had during the days when they had the Beatles and Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon, and, you know, that's all I had to say was that the same thing as Dark Side of the Moon.
So this is a stereo preamp. It's called a what? A Chandler
Limited.
Like Dave Chandler?
Yep.
Chandler Limited.
And a lot of people prefer these over the knees.
Wow, dude. And that's just an isolated pre from the console, right?
Yes.
What would you like to say to all of us people?
I don't know. Just, I mean, guys broke up, 15 years ago, next month, and to have people that are still around listening to this music and getting involved in newer music that's coming out from the members, and just it's unreal that people are still into it this many years later, and I mean young people that are discovering Kaius, it's so weird that it keeps going. It blows my mind. And I guess I would just say thanks to anybody that's had their ear pinched a little bit and got curious.
Scott, you gave me two discs here to play a few things off of. One is from your EP called Weaver's Dawn. And what would you like me to play on that one?
As We Become.
As We Become.
Yeah, that was it's kind of a love song my wife on our 20th anniversary.
That's gorgeous, man. You've been married for 20 years?
23 coming up in a couple of weeks.
23 in a couple of weeks. Dude, man, yeah. Tearing up. That's awesome.
It's crazy. Now, can you use bad language on your show?
Yes. Of course you can.
Then my favorite song on my full length is Fuck You All.
Okay, fuck you all. Fuck you all, and we will do that on your full length. Fuck you all. Takes a long time to show me. Takes a long time to show what friendship's worth to you. But if you got time to show me, I'll be like a friend that you have known since birth. Oh. But if you got a mind to burn me, dig another hole so you can charge the ones before. Please accept. Fuck you all.
This is Scott Reeder of Caius, the Obsessed, and Goatsnake. And you're listening to Heady Metal with Jeff Olson.
Hey, Scott, we're going to send you some beer from Allagash Brewing Company.